Greetings. This week we're going to talk about the message to Pergamum from Revelation 2, verses 12 through 17. Before we get into the scripture, I am going to give you a little background about the city of Pergamum. It was the capital, the Roman capital of Asia, and had been at the time of John's writing for almost 400 years. It was established as the Roman authority in the area. It was not a center of trade like the previous cities we have talked about, but it was a center for culture. There was a significant library there, one that actually started a feud between the city of Pergamum and the city of Alexandria, the library at Alexandria, which is one of the seven wonders of the ancient world. So much so, actually, this feud persisted that the king of Pergamum tried to take the curator of the library in Alexandria for his library, resulting in Ptolemy of Egypt forbidding the sale of papyrus to Pergamum, which was a problem because papyrus was the predominant way to write things down. And so the king of Pergamum and the people of Pergamum developed parchment, which is from animal skin. So vellum or parchment was created because of this feud between Alexandria and Pergamum. And in fact, our word for parchment is derived from Pergamum. It was also a center for pagan worship. There was an enormous altar to Zeus up above the city on a hill that was in the shape of a throne, where animal sacrifices were burnt continually, 24/7. And so constantly there would have been this plume of smoke coming up, reminding the people of Zeus. There was also a large cult to Asclepius, who is the god of healing. So there were basically hospitals or sanatoriums kind of scattered in the city where people would bring their sick family and friends to be blessed by the sacred snakes of Asclepius. It was a hard place to be a Christian, as most of these cities are. There would have been considerable pressure, not just with these Greek gods, to worship them, but also the temple to the emperor was there as well. And so the pressure to call Caesar Lord would be ever present and would affect Christians' abilities to function, to have businesses, to interact with people in the city of Pergamum. I think now I'm going to read our passage and annotate it as we go, beginning in verse 12. And to the angel of the church in Pergamum write, these are the words of him who has the sharp two-edged sword. So we have the reference to Jesus as the one who has the sharp two-edged sword. And we know that the sword is symbolic of the word of God. So Jesus's words are cutting, are strong, are stand in contrast to this Roman proconsul, because the Roman proconsul for Pergamum had the right of the sword, and that is the ability to execute people indiscriminately. So his right, the Roman proconsul's right to the sword, is contrasted here with Jesus's, with the sword of the word of God, Jesus, who has the sharp two-edged sword. And he will use it later. We'll talk about using it, and so we'll get back to that. Okay, in 13, I know where you are living, where Satan's throne is, yet you are holding fast to my name. So Satan's throne, that is a striking thing. And it's possible that this is a reference to the altar of Zeus that looks like a throne. It is possible that it is a reference to Asclepius and his serpents, because serpents are often associated with Satan. But probably it is more to do with the Roman capital, with the seat of authority for Rome in Asia. Yet you are holding fast to my name, and you did not deny your faith in me, even in the days of Antipas, my witness, my faithful one, who was killed among you where Satan lives. Now, unfortunately, we do not know any more about Antipas, but he's mentioned here as a faithful witness. And the Greek for that witness is martyr. Martyr came to be our word for people who laid down their life for their beliefs because they were a witness to what they believed in. And so the Greek here, faithful witness, faithful martyr, is also spoken of Jesus. So here we have Jesus actually lending his title to Antipas, who was faithful. It also speaks to the amount of persecution that was happening in this city. Picking up again in 14, but I have a few things against you. You have some there who hold to the teaching of Balaam, who taught Balak to put a stumbling block before the people of Israel so that they would eat food sacrificed to idols and practice fornication. And so you also have some who hold to the teaching of the Nicolaitans. Repent. Actually, I'll stop right there. Nicolaitans and Balaam. We talked about this a couple weeks ago with Ephesus. Nicholas and Balaam mean the same thing. Balaam in Hebrew, Nicholas in Greek mean conquerors of people or maybe even seducers of people. So these are teachers, I think we are supposed to understand, that corrupted those who would listen and follow them. The stumbling block here, so that they would eat food sacrificed to idols and practice fornication, those are the things listed in the New Testament that the council in Jerusalem said, you don't have to convert to Judaism in order to be a Christian if you are a Gentile, but you should refrain from these things. And it sounds like an easy thing to do, but most of the food, most of the meat in these cities would have been sacrificed first and then offered at market. Paul says not to ask too many questions and to eat with the freedom of conscience, but participating in the rituals, which is possibly what they're talking about here, participating in the rituals of animal sacrifice to these Greek and Roman gods, or participating in the cult, the temple prostitution, prostitutes in the area, would have been things that would have been socially acceptable and maybe even expected. And there would have been significant pressure to conform in these ways, but Christians have been requested not to. And so we have Balaam and the Nicolaitans specifically mentioned with the idea of people conforming to the worst parts of their culture, making compromises between their Christian beliefs and faith and practice and the practice of the culture that was worshiping Caesar. Okay, so then in 16, repent then. If not, I will come to you soon and make war against them with the sword of my mouth. So we have all, we've been, here's our reference to the sword again. Jesus is saying, repent. Change your ways. Do not conform to the worst aspects of your society, of your culture, but rather change. Repent, change your ways, seek out where you are wrong, and change. And I love that this here, if not, I will come to you and make war against them. So even in the midst of Jesus's judgment, of the people in this church and indeed of us, there's still room for mercy, right? I will not make war with you. I'm telling you I love you. I'm telling you to change. I'm telling you to come back. I'm telling you, says Jesus, to enjoy the fullness of what I have to offer. And so even in this judgment, even in this condemnation, there is still mercy. Let anyone, picking up in 17, let anyone who has an ear listen to what the Spirit is saying to the churches. To everyone who conquers, I will give some of the hidden manna, and I will give a white stone, and on the white stone is written a new name that no one knows except the one who receives it. This imagery is beautiful. It's personal, that God will give the manna, the bread of life, to the person who conquers. But I think there's also instruction here that just because we have ears does not mean we always listen. And so there is instruction here to listen. As you read these passages or these verses, I would encourage you to think of something that stands out to you. Think about how your church is similar or different from the church in Pergamum, and ask the Spirit to speak to you through this passage. And I would love to hear in the comments your answers to any of those questions. Thank you.